Welcome to Iconic Sonics. My name is Mike Gastineau, and we thank you for dialing us up and finding us and enjoying what is going to be a very fun conversation. It's all brought to you by the Swinomish Casino, our presenting sponsor. We also love the support we get from Dick's Drive-In Restaurants, and our nonprofit sponsor on Iconic Sonics this year is a terrific organization called runfreely.org. We delve into culture and music, and we reminisce a little bit about the 90s today with two of the best people I've had the chance to meet over the years. And they're heating it up right now. Sir Mix-a-Lot, who came directly from the studio. We're recording in the morning, but Mix has been up most of the night working. The work ethic is, especially for a slacker like me, that impresses me, Mix. So thank you. It's great to see and hear you again, man.
Actually, I'm still in the studio. That's where I'm at right now. So I'll be here all day wiring up stuff. So let's rock it, man. Yeah. Unless you guys want some work. You can always
there you go. And Jason Finn from the Presidents of the United States of America, he held down the beat for that great band for all their years. Mm-hmm. Worked in several other Seattle bands and may or may not have been in a studio yet this morning. Probably has just had breakfast, if I had to guess.
I've had a nutritious breakfast. I've also thrown a tennis ball to a 20-pound dog about 20 times outside. And so I've got the blood circulating and all and ready to go.
I want to reminisce with you guys about the music that you were involved in with the Sonics in the 90s. But first, I want to talk about what's going on now. I think you guys are maybe working on something. I know you're both working all the time. Mix, what's happening in your world these days?
I'm getting ready for like a 30th anniversary of Baby Got Back. So we're doing NFTs, which is like, I feel like a dinosaur walking around amongst, you know, but it's I'm starting to figure it out, starting to get it a little bit, but it's a confusing space. To say the least, but yeah, we're working on that right now and got a lot of booking tours for next year, although those shows probably won't happen. Most likely we'll get another break and be back home for another year, which is fine with me. Tell you the truth, I've been enjoying it.
Hey, really the lack of road work and all that, I mean, it's driving everybody a little bit crazy, but you know what, we're also finding out you do get to a point in your life where being at home isn't horrible.
I love it, man. I mean, I lost like, now think about this. I was on tour, running around, doing shows, sweating every night, gaining weight. I come home where I should be gaining, and I lost like 42 pounds or something like that. So staying at home ain't bad, man.
I was going to say, you look great, man. They say the camera adds 10 pounds. I don't know. You look fantastic. So good for you. How much you dropped? 42?
Mix your, you're disappearing, man. You're going to be gone in a second.
You sound like the press.
what to call him Sir Mix-a-Little if he gets any smaller. It's going to be hard to call him a lot. And I want to get back to something you said about NFTs, which Jason's going to explain that to me later off air. It will take too long. But Jason, first of all, bring me up to date on what you're up to these days and what projects are taking up your time.
Well, I'm mostly between stuff at the moment, which is great. I like Mix-a-Lot. I feel like it's easier to feel good and look good from one's home than the road. And I have thoughts on that, actually. I invented a theory about this, which has gotten no traction and made me no money, but I want to share it with you real quick.
All right.
It's that when you're on tour, whether you're the big star or the drummer or the crew guy or the tour manager, doesn't matter. You're traveling. And all day long, you have to be somewhere. Your schedule says at 1 o'clock, you'll be here. At 2 o'clock, you'll be there. At 3 o'clock, you'll be there. 4 to 7, you'll be there. At the same time, there is nothing to do.
Yes.
Zero things to do. So this makes your brain and your body go, what is happening to me? It doesn't make any sense. And it just fouls up all the calibrators. So that's what I've got. I haven't named it yet. There we go. Yeah. But please send money at Jason Finn.
He is so correct on that. I'm going to tell you, man, you get on the road and you think, boy, this is going to be like a vacation. And I drive because I pick up more shows when I drive. So I drive and I hate flying. But same thing. It's like, hurry up and get there. Hurry up and get there. Hurry up and get there. You think, boy, when I get there, I'm going to relax. No, as soon as you get there, sound check. Group's got to eat, you know, who's going to pay us? What time, you know, who broke my damn turntable? It just, man,
even if it's not sound check, it's from 6:30 to 7:15, you will be relaxing. because it says so on the thing, you know.
I think it's the biggest misconception, those of us who are fans and we're on the outside of your world, and especially when you're younger, you know, the more you read about it and you learn. But I think for young people who are music fans, they go, oh, man, I'd love to go out on tour with you. I could be the T-shirt guy, or I could be the mixer. You know, and from what I've been told by most musicians is you'd get tired of it in about a week, if not less, right?
Certainly the T-shirt guy would. Yeah. Yeah. That's hard work. And half the time they're driving a truck by themselves behind the bus.
Right.
That's particularly brutal. But that said, you know what? It is a younger person's game, and they're right. They will love it for many, many years. And that's not to say that Mix and I don't still potentially love it at some point, picking our spots.
Yeah.
There's just, you age out of being a road dog.
You know what it is, Gas? Is like the show is this much of your day.
Right.
Yeah. It's the other stuff you hate. When I'm on the stage, I feel great, right? And then I have to help break down gear, carry stuff. Oh, we got to drive back to the hotel. I'm sweaty. My shirt's sticking to me. Oh, man. And then you got to rinse, repeat.
Right.
Next morning, you're doing it all over again, driving to some godforsaken spot in the middle of, Underarm, Idaho somewhere.
We've done some performing together over the years, and I gotta say, I'm on record, I have never seen you help break down the gear.
If you're
saying it does happen, I'm not saying you're lying or anything. I just haven't seen it.
Oh no, I break down the gear when we're on the road. Okay. I know there's a drummer we had named Jason Finn. That guy would let me touch a drumstick. He's like,
that's right. Diva. Real diva material. Yeah.
Hey, you guys, Matt, you mentioned NFTs earlier. And again, I've got no concept of what those are. In part of the bigger discussion about technology, Mix, and you were talking, you know, before you and I were chatting, you were really into the tech side of this before you got into the performing side. You love putting stuff together, putting studios together and helping people get started. As the technology changes so dramatically, are you into that, or is there a side of you going, man, I can't believe I got to learn something new? Is it fun to get new stuff to learn, or is it more of a pain? Like I'm used to doing it this way.
It is absolutely, it's a huge amount of fun for me, but I always have a little, is it going to benefit me first? I've learned, because I used to just try to take on everything. I'd buy this new piece of gear. I paid $3,000 for it. Then I realized, I got a piece that costs $500. It does it 10 times faster and better, you know? So I've learned to do a little research before I write those checks, but it's a ball, man. I have a ball doing it. Like I said, I have a bunch of new gear coming in, like hopefully in the next couple of days, and I'm gonna wire it up. But that was my first love anyway. Mm-hmm. When your love is being a star, you probably won't be happy too long in this business.
It's an interesting point, because that stuff comes and goes, but the music, the creating, all that, it hangs around. Finn, I know you're a guy who always likes whatever the newest tech is or the newest gadget. It feels to me, maybe not. What do you enjoy the challenges of learning the new things as it relates to, say, the music business?
Oh, geez. I mean, I'm not opposed to learning new stuff. I've taken two or three whacks at the NFT research, and I end up just lying on the couch weeping. I'm not quite up to speed yet, and that stuff, honestly, it's a little more than I can handle on my plate. That said, we're looking at stuff and thinking about stuff, and we do have this one album that is kind of just out there that needs a kind of a way to get into the universe. I think it's a little ask again in 4 months.
And that's the project you guys worked on together, right? Is that what you're referring to, or not? Or is there something else?
Well, sure. Yeah. In this instance, I'm talking about the record that the four of us, that is to say me and my president's bandmates, Dave and Chris and Mix here, made some time ago under the name Subset, which was really just a very brief collaboration. We had a lot of fun. We played a bunch of times in Seattle, and people really reacted to it. We did a little sort of in and out, quickie recording, which we have dusted off recently, and it's standing up for us. So
yeah.
Don't look for the 300 Day World Tour or anything, but we do want to get it sort of all the way out there. So stay tuned.
Well, it's a shame because if you're not going to do 300 cities, I'm already receiving a lot of feedback from Upper Armpit, Idaho, and they want you guys back. They love the show and they want to see the whole thing again. And they're very discouraged that they're not going to get to see it if you don't do 300 cities.
The Upper Armpit community has always been really strong for us. Yeah.
Iconic Sonics is presented by Swinomish Casino and Lodge. You guys were both involved in two very cool projects that tied the music community to the Sonics in the 90s. And you know, the 90s Sonics were a special group. They were so good. They did everything but win a championship. And I always say we get a little hung up sometimes on, you know, if you didn't win the championship, it's not memorable. That's not true. The 90s Sonics were a show every night for about 6 or 7 years. I'd argue that's in some ways harder than winning a championship. Now the Bulls would say, well, we were a show every night for 8 years. We won 6 championships. Yeah. I get it. Mix, let's talk about, first of all, let's listen to a second to a song Sonics fans know, Not in Our House, which was released in advance, I believe, of the 92-93 playoffs, the 93 playoffs, if you will. Not in Our House by Sir Mix-a-Lot and several members of the Sonics.
It ain't that easy, G.
No, not in our house.
We ain't letting y'all sink no threes.
No.
So Mix, that song resonates all these years later with me. I loved it when it came out. And the first thing I thought when I was listening back to it and getting ready for the show is within hip hop, rap, whatever genre we want to call this, the ability to rhyme and speak fast. I mean, I know you can write stuff down and everything, but talking fast and keeping things straight is a hard skill, in my opinion. Is that something that came to you or was that learned with practice? The ability to just go it as rapidly as you can talk and still make sense and have the rhymes work. Does that come to an artist over the years or is that learned from the beginning?
Well, it comes to you before you're an artist, because if you can't do it, you're not an artist yet. Basically, you know, you write something. Me personally, everybody does it differently. I grab syllables first, right? Mm-hmm. So I'll just literally back then get on to like a Walkman radio or something, and I just utter a bunch of syllables. And then I insert words, right? Got but it. The words have to make sense, which is hard to do also.
Right.
You can just say the, it, and when, and then that's not going to fly, right? So for me, it's really just to get the syllables down packed. And once I get the syllables down packed, I've already practiced that. So all I got to do is insert the words and do them and do them and do them and do them until you learn them by heart where you don't have to read them. And that's when you know it's going to sound right. But when you're reading, you can actually hear it when you track something that you didn't read. You're like, this is horrible. Yeah, it doesn't. I'd love to say I was doing like Eminem, who can just look at your tennis shoes and spit 40 bars about tennis shoes and you know, right off the top of his head. But I can't do that.
Right. Well, hang on a second. Back it up here, because when we were doing the subset stuff together, I remember more than once, like just standing with Dave afterwards or something, and going, "What is wrong with that guy? He just came in and just started doing everything perfectly right away out of the air. What the heck is he? How is it happening?"
Because but, you guys had a groove.
Maybe you had been preparing ahead of time, but you always seem to just be like, okay, I'm completely airtight on this from rep one. But
did I mention
I'm also an actor? I may have been heavily sedated too. So, and that was a long time ago. So,
well, now where did Not in Our House come from? I mean, how much time did you have on that? Because to me, if the team approached you, I know the way that business works. It's always last minute. Hey, we came up with a great idea. Could you do a song for us? And we're going to need it in a couple of days when the playoffs start.
You know,
what was the origin of that?
If I'm not mistaken, somebody made an attempt at doing it from somebody from Portland.
Mm-hmm.
I think. I can't remember dead on, but I think somebody else tried to do it. I heard it. I wasn't that crazy about the chorus, but I realized it wasn't my song. So I just start talking crazy. And you know, the double time rap, I think was in retrospect kind of sucked. Because people that love the Sonics wanted to hear what I was saying. But getting in the studio with those guys, man, you know, you got, and I'm gonna tell you, Steve Scheffler, I gotta give him credit. This dude was a human punching bag in there. I mean, guys, He's trying to dance. Nobody liked his dancing. He tried to, It was just Scheffler. But Scheffler, he was a good sport, man. He was a good sport because, I mean, Sean, Gary, Sam, they did everything but hit him with beanbags, man, and he took it like a champ.
He was, I mean, it's funny because that extended to why he was with the team for a few years. He was the 12th guy. He never complained about it. He yeah. could give a few minutes if you needed it in a pinch, but he was that guy. I mean, he did not fit the mold of that team, and that's kind of what made him perfect, and it made it perfect in your song.
Yeah, and he'd come out and put the lumber on people when he had to. You know, he'd go out and, you know, run up a couple of fouls on somebody, put Elijah Wan on his ass a couple times. You know, we need that help, you know, and he would go out there and do it, whatever the team wanted.
The video for that is so awesome. And I'm assuming it was shot at your studio and it's a lot.
No.
I mean,
no, it was shot in Seattle. I forget the name of the studio. It used to be kind of off Broadway a little bit. I forget the name of the studio, but we shot it there. Yeah.
And what's cool about it. Yeah. That's because you're not gonna get all the Sonics to drive out. You live way out in the hinterlands. I'm not going out there. The cool thing for fans though, is you really see a snapshot of the early 90s, the loud sweaters, the hair styles,
and rocking the box top. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, as you look back on it, you've done a lot of great things. I mean, from a sports perspective, it's obviously a real fun song for everybody. I'm assuming for you, it's still one that you're real proud of and fun. It captured this city's imagination for a couple of months around that playoff run. I mean, everybody knew everything about that song.
Yeah, you know, the song, though, that I think the players kind of liked more was the one I did after that. When I said Feed the Hawk, what was the name of that one?
God, I don't remember that.
That one was, man, the people liked that one a lot more, but Not in Our House, obviously, got the fans more into it because it was a chant, you know.
Yeah.
It ain't going to happen here, but yeah, that King of the West Side, that was what it was
called. Oh, yep. Yeah.
Who's the King of the West Side?
And that one, I think that might have been the inspiration for Eric Snow during the 96 finals run. He got that thing started, and then it became a real call and response with the fans of yelling Super, and everybody would yell Sonics.
Yeah.
I mean, that kind of stuff. And we're going to talk about some stadium anthems a little later on. When you create, I've had guy Bruce Hornsby told me once, not to drop names, but I'll drop Bruce Hornsby's name.
That's the name you want to drop right
he
out
He wrote
of
a song that. Called Rainbow Cadillac that's terrific about a legendary summer league player named Rainbow who was just a great basketball player. And he said, he sat on the song for a while. He told me, Mix, sports songs can sound so jive if you're not careful.
Yeah.
You know, you got to do a good job of them or they end up sounding kind of hokey.
Yeah, I thought Not in Our House to me was a little, it wasn't written the way I would have probably done it from scratch, but somebody had already kind of gave me some parameters and I had to stay within those parameters. So I'm like, what the hell? I get to kick it with the guys. So,
yeah. And it comes out to me, it's a great song. People, they loved it. People sang it. Again, it was in the arena every night. It was that had to be kind of a fun thing because it connected you in a way, and you knew these guys, but it connected you to this run. And 92-93 is the first run under George as they get to the seventh game of the Western Conference Finals, and they really captured the town's imagination.
Yeah. And I got some, we'll deal with this later, but I got some enemies in Houston right now that we've been arguing about this for 20 years. At least.
There's a Houston-Seattle beef.
Well, with my guys, because I got some friends, they're in the industry. I'm not going to say their names. They're not here to defend themselves, although I will call them punks in a minute. But I remind them that when Jordan stepped away for those 2 years and Houston got their championships, if I'm not mistaken, we were almost undefeated versus Houston.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
We got bumped by the Nick Van Exel-led Lakers, and we got Mutombo on the floor. Oh, God, man, I can't. I never will forget that when I saw that. I was on tour and Mutombo celebrating with this ball. I'm like, no!
God! Yeah.
You can't. It has, so my Houston guys, F you.
You know what's interesting about that is then in 96 when they finally break through and they played Houston in the second round and they swept them. That's rare in the NBA playoffs, especially into the second round. And they didn't destroy them every game, but they were in control of every game. There's no lucky shot at the end. And I think that was them kind of saying, you know we screwed up. And if we had been around, it would have been a different story.
Yep. Agreed.
Not in Our House is 92, 93. I'm trying to think then, Jason, you guys get involved with a song called Supersonics, not just a regular team.
Seattle Supersonics.
There you go. A toe tapper, to be sure, powered by the great drumming of our guest, Jason Finn, the president of the United States of America, and Supersonics, not just a regular team, featuring Kevin Calabro on guest vocals. Is that 95 maybe when that happens? I can't remember the exact year. I think 95.
Yeah, I was trying to piece that together too. I'm going to say it was 96 because it's the music bed is from a song that's on our second record called Supermodel.
Right.
So it was pretty easy for us to sort of restructure it as a Supersonic song. I think we just started doing it as a joke one night, you know, replacing the chorus line at a gig and then sort of built it from there. So I'm going to say that was probably 96, but that it was definitely in time for the 96 playoffs.
Right. Right.
Because I remember clearly, this is so crazy. We played the Riviera in Chicago the night of game five. And we had, of the finals. And we all had Sonics sleeveless jerseys on, and the promoter came back and begged us not to go out with those. And the Bulls were already up 3-0 in this series.
Right.
And we're arguing with the guy. We're like, come on, man. Everyone's here. They're not watching the game, which is on TV right now. These are not the people that are going to, throw fruit at us. We're going to be fine.
Right.
And
right.
We went out there and it was fine. Everybody laughed their asses off at us. We brought out a TV to check the scores a couple times, which didn't really work as theater as well you would have liked, because you know the TVs were little back then, but everyone had a nice time and it was fine. Anyways, I'm certain that Supersonics was already a song by then. It grew organically as a live thing. And I went back and listened yesterday. I just don't remember. We definitely did re-record the music for that version.
Mm.
May have had something to do with the legalities of Columbia Records or what, yada, 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 yada.
Right.
But it's very similar, but it's a little bit different. And my greatest disappointment is that my favorite line of the song is one that Chris just didn't like and he replaced it. It's in the second verse, and I'll just be a second here. And the line is, and this is the one that he took out because he did not like it. It's like something like, 15 seconds to play, Detlef with the baseline, Jay, foul in the 3-point bonus, Sarunas, Marshallonis, which is just next level, right? I mean, this guy, nobody knew where the hell this guy came from. Was he on the team for 2 years? I don't know. Maybe he was no longer on the team. Maybe that's why we cut the line. But it is just an enduring thing in my mind. And I think that Chris and I argued bitterly about it, and yeah. I lost as always. But
hey, that's a cool line. I like that line.
Well, it's an excellent line. And Sarunas was a guy who, you know, he did exactly what we asked him to do, as far as I know, which was come off the bench and just act like a friggin' lunatic the whole time. Like he wasn't a big move the ball guy. He was just like, give me the ball, I want to shoot. And 6 minutes later, he's back sitting down.
You rhyme in the bonus with Marshallonis, and you should take the rest of the day off. That's
what I'm saying.
It's great
virtuoso
work.
Level stuff. I don't remember there did end up being an official, you know, in the Sonic store. I think for Music Cares, the charity Music Cares, that mm-hmm. you could buy this CD single. So that's probably why we recorded its own version. But the team never asked us to do it. I think kind of like Mix-a-Lot's talking about there, they eventually found out about it and asked to collab on it or something like that. And we've done other stuff. We did a Seahawks song years after that. That was about the mascot Blitz. And, you know,
right. I remember that. Yeah.
There ended up being a lot of back and forth. We got a bunch of notes about the lyrics from the office and stuff. And it's just, sometimes that stuff, you know, the creativity just takes a set of backs. Oh, I think they took issue with the way in which we use the number 12 in some lyric because legal stuff, you know.
Right.
Right. Nick's not nodding. He's like, yeah, that sounds like the NFL. We did end up eventually performing not just Supersonics, but I think five songs after a game at Key Arena, not in 96. This would have been a couple of years later, maybe 5 or 6 years later. Who was the tall, black-haired European kid that was pretty good, power forward for a couple of years?
Vladimir Radmanovic.
Yes. So he was on the team. And I remember him just standing on the side. This is right after the game. And he just was looking at me like I was an axe murderer. He just was not getting it. And so that's whatever year that was. I don't know.
Hey, and Vladimir Radmanovic got the best nickname ever hung on him. And if he had stayed here and been a superstar, even bigger, he was not a superstar. He was a good player. I liked his game.
Yeah.
But Calabro hung Broadway Joe on him. And when you look at a photo, yeah, and the best part about that was Radmanovic, you know, didn't grow up here. He had no idea what the reference to Broadway Joe meant. But I remember telling him, I said, well, I'll tell you, it's spot on. You look just like him. He was a big hit with the ladies and he was a big star. So it's a good nickname for you.
He was also quite handsome. That's for sure. And just broadly speaking, I do want to say that the era of Sonic that we're talking about, a little pre-Radmanovic, early 90s through 96, I think that they're kind of getting their due now with the whole country. There's a huge podcast that I'm not going to mention right now that had a whole thing about like how wildly charismatic those teams were. And we know that, and we've always perceived that, but at least I've always felt like, well, okay, nobody even remembers Gary and Sean. But it turns out that people, you know, of a certain age remember Gary and Sean. I think they've aged as well or better than like, you know, the Malone Stockton Jazz or something. They were fun every night, like you were saying. So, and is it our fault that we ran right into the teeth of the best, biggest dynasty ever? No, I say no.
I agree.
You know, and I don't know how we ended up winning two games there, but we did.
Michael Jordan said that was, of all the finals he won, he said that was the hardest one. He said that.
There you go.
Yeah.
Well, and he, you know, it was funny because in the Last Dance, which was terrific, I thought, and really did show a great side of the NBA in the 90s. He talks about when they put Peyton on him, it wasn't a big deal. Well, his numbers went down. Look, Peyton didn't shut him down, but Michael did not have free reign after game three, and that's how the Sonics kind of got back in the series. And
that's what I loved about the Sonics, man. They had a set where they had balls, and I'm serious, man. I got to hear them, you know, not in front of the camera, and hear Gary and Sean, and I love all the four-letter words.
Well, Jason said something that I thought was interesting, Mix, and then following up, talking about the Jazz a little bit, the 90s Sonics were the perfect team for this town at that time. The music scene is exploding. The tech scene is exploding. Dot-com millionaires are getting made every day. Coffee, beer, you know, all these cool things are spinning out of here. If you traded those two, if we had the Jazz, who were a great team, but kind of a walk it up, pick and roll, beat you to death. I mean, look, they were winners, so we'd have loved them. But the Sonics were the kind of high-flying, you know, the team was named after a plane, for crying out loud. That 90s-era Sonics team was perfect for this community.
And even the announcer, man, when you – that jackhammer slam. I mean, oh, God, man. I could listen to Calabro. Literally, I worked on a video game for Microsoft back in the day, and Kevin Calabro was calling these NBA plays, and I was mixing some of them like, man, I could listen to this all day long. Sure. I mean, that team, we would brag on them every city we went to. We bragged and we talked about how boring the Jazz were and, you know, how Houston was a fake. Everywhere we went, we'd say it on stage, and that didn't usually end well. But, you know, I was young, dumb, and full of you-know-what back then.
Yeah.
It's funny. I'd watch the games. I was doing the post-game show at the time, and I'd walk from the arena down to the radio station about four blocks. And a lot of nights, the whole time I'm walking, I'm like, I can't wait to hear what Calabro said about that play and that one play that Sean did. I want to hear. And almost always it would not disappoint. I'd walk in and our producer, Terry Reed, would be, where do you hear this? What do you hear? Mm-hmm. And they were perfect. They were a perfect fit for this town. And I just, you think back on him. Like I said, if they'd have won one, they'd really be an NBA legend. But Jason, you bring up a good point. People are starting to remember now that, and you know why they're coming back into vogue, in my opinion, Jason, is they, and both of you, they played the game kind of the way the game is being played now. They played outside in, they have big guys on the perimeter.
Yeah. They stretch it. Yeah. Yeah, for sure.
I remember George saying one time at like the first practice of the year saying, we believe the 3-pointer should be a primary weapon for this team. It might've been the year they moved the 3-point line in for the NBA.
And for that reason, we have acquired Frank Brakowski.
That's right. That's right. I mean, they had guys that could just, Dre, it was a fun time. Well, I wanted to talk to you guys about stadium sports songs. As I said earlier, it's, you know, I think if you try to write one, I think it's like what you said, Jason, you gotta kind of let just come to you. Hey, this is something we just started. If you try, it's awfully hard. What's the best mix in your mind? What's the best stadium sports song, say the last 25, 30 years that you enjoy hearing? Or do you have one that comes to mind?
I don't really, because the ones I have that get me going sometimes are those old corny traditional. I don't know what it is. I would never listen to them outside of a sports arena or
right
a venue, but the corny ones that everybody, how, you know, and they have to play stuff for people that don't have rhythm. Most people at games tend to not have rhythm. So you always get, da-na-na, hey, da-na-na, oh my God. And it's something about it, when you listen to it in context and you're at the game, you get fired up, even though that song sucks. I get fired up. Every time I hear it, I want to just go whoop somebody's ass. You know what I mean? Wasn't there a Lenny Kravitz song? Are you gonna go? What's that? Are you gonna?
Yeah. Are you gonna go my way? Reminds me of the '93 Sonics. They played it in the fourth quarter of every home game that year. It felt like.
I'm gonna go my way, and I got to know it.
Yeah, I think that the NBA was more about just playing popular songs then. I don't think they'd really honed it in the way they did, like say 10 years after that. With their music science.
I don't know if the story is 100% accurate. It was portrayed in the movie this way, but when Queen were working up We Will Rock You, and then they were like, we want to do something that lets the fans play with the band, and that's where they came with the don't clap, don't clap.
Buddy, you're a boy, make a big noise, playing in the street, gonna be a big man someday. You got mud on your face, you big dish.
Speaking of no rhythm, and you watch them in the studio in the movie version, and it's Hollywooded up a little bit, but you think, man, that must have been a magical moment when they heard that and said, yeah, you know what, that will work, because that's one that, again, is ubiquitous. It's worldwide, right, Finn? I mean, it's absolutely everywhere.
Yeah, I think in that case, it's pretty established canon that they did sort of consciously engineer that. I remain skeptical of the actual version that's in the movie there. Hey, guys, just come over here and stand
right
on it, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know. Pretty good movie. I don't know.
Right, but I know what you mean.
You got
a Hollywood.
And there, like Nick's is saying, there are certainly elements where you can sort of stack the odds in your favor. Or if you're the music director, you can sort of create the energy that you want. And the one, I gave it a little thought. Again, this was yesterday. And my kind of favorite, but also actual biggest complaint about this is Thunderstruck by AC/DC, which is used all the time, usually in baseball, and usually that saddest of all the musical phenomena, the closer music. I think this is Trevor Hoffman's fault. I'm almost certain of it. It's just like, okay, are we guys, all of you too dumb to know that it's, you know, the closer's coming. Okay, it's effective. It's fine. Like Mix, I would rather just get on with it. How about let's bring back a real organist?
Well, you know what's funny, man? I noticed that, and it depends on where you're at, what part of the country you're in. Seattle, I think if the Sonics were around now, I think the music would be more hip now.
Oh, because yeah.
The reason they use We Will Rock You, the reason they use Are You Gonna Go My Way is because it's simple.
Yeah.
Right.
You know,
right.
People are a bunch of old FUs, you know, people with no rhythm. And it's just like, nah, man. But now, Yeah, I mean, you go down. You ever listen to Atlanta games? I mean, they almost have a DJ out there, chup, 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 scratching and playing hip hop, and you know, because the whole crowd is that's Atlanta. That's what they do. Same thing in New York. Well, not in New York because the Knicks are kind of that ownership issues right there. But
it's too sad for music in New York. Exactly. It's too sad.
What about, and one of the things that it to me was fun, because these guys seem like good guys, and Mix, I think they were, you know, that their hit came around the time you were rocking in the 90s, a tag team with Whoomp, There It Is, and that becomes a TV commercial 30 years later. It's, again, it gets back to, it's a simple, you know, easy song for people to sing to and all that, and a fun song too. And I think that's a key to a sports song. You better have some fun in there, because people are at the game and their team's winning. They don't want something too serious or dirgy.
Hey, what's interesting about Whoop, There It Is, 5 years prior to it coming out, that could have been a song you played in a strip club.
Oh, yeah.
Like in black strip clubs, they would play that because the girls would do that pop stuff, you know, that I love so much. And but the fact that it came back in that commercial, I did a show with those guys, and it was really interesting that they milked it, and they should, you know, because they said, we're not going to milk this. And then they did the whole Geico thing, and they started stirring. And
yeah. I like
chocolata, that. Chocolata.
They did the interview last year, and they said, yeah, every time we think this thing's over, we get a call from somebody, and we're making more money on it. I mean, good for them. Good. Great for them. Because it is, you know, when you write a song that holds the imagination for that many years, and again, it's not the most complex song ever, but man, is it good.
And many times artists, in my opinion, artists kill their own success because they have a great song and they get sick of playing it, but they don't realize the fans are the bosses here. So when you tell the fans it's not a good song anymore, they usually leave the artist and everything, and the artist just fizzles out. And you get that a lot, especially with these, bands do it more than individual artists, I think.
Yeah.
They have a tendency to run from their hits, and that is usually their demise. Yep.
I have seen some of that in real time happening with people, even some in this region. And yeah, I agree. You gotta play them, because
man,
if you don't like them that much, that's just bad luck for you, I guess. I don't know.
I want to drop my second name of the podcast, but I happen to be,
after Bruce Hornsby, Hornsby.
I'm going to top that. And the point of it is how you can deal with this stuff. I happened to meet Rick Nielsen of Cheap Trick one night at the Showbox, and we were talking. There was a group of us talking. He wasn't all interested in me, but somebody was saying, he's saying, on this tour, I think I might have asked him, you know, you're still using Hello There as the opener, which is the greatest concert opening song ever, I've always thought. Hello there, ladies and gentlemen. Hello there, ladies and gentlemen. And he says, we play it second. We've started opening with I Want You to Want Me. I want you to want me. Look was kind of like, you know, what you're saying. It's like, we got to play this, and we've played it so often. Let's just play it first. And I didn't say get it out of the way. He didn't use that phrase certainly, but the idea, just play it first. And then we go into the rest of the set. And cause you got to acknowledge the big stuff you've written.
Yeah. It's the dumbest thing in the world when artists put themselves in front of the fans, because without the fans, you're just you're back at home in an apartment making songs nobody's going to hear. So I believe in, when I do Baby Got Back, I do it last, and I do a 10-minute version. I bring girls on the stage, you know, because that's what they're there for.
Right. And that, to me, is what makes you a great performer. It's what makes anybody who's good at this great, is you've got to somehow be able to play it like you've never played it before. First night we've ever debuted this song, and in reality, how many thousands of times have you played that song? But you can't act bored by it.
And I find myself telling people, hey, you know, I did this verse. You should hear it. It's better than any verse I've ever written.
Yeah,
but can you give us Baby Got Back first? I've learned just you can slip things in as long as you still do your, you know, the main tracks. And don't do truncated versions of your biggest songs. Those are career killers, in my opinion, also. I mean, it took me a long time to learn that, because I tried doing shows without Baby Got Back. Boy, man, promoters wanted their money back.
You know. Promoter want money back. You should write that song. There's one for you. Guys, it's fun catching up with you and hearing some great stuff. Let me ask you just the last thing and kind of turn it in a different direction is you've both reached a point in your career. And I know this is something that you've both done where, you know, it's funny how fast life zooms by and suddenly, you know, it seems like about 10 minutes ago, you're the guy, you're creating, you're still creating, but I mean, you're looking to find influences and mentors to help you. And all of a sudden one day you look in the mirror and you realize now people are coming to me. And Mix, I know you've been great about this. You've had one hand behind you the whole way, pulling other people along, saying, come on, come with me, I'll help you. What was it like? How hard is it to be a mentor? And what are the things you enjoy about it? Because you've done it to a lot of people.
Well, I can tell you quickly what I don't like about it is that the expectations. I can mix your record. I try not to give people ideas because sometimes they go, dude, you're 58 years old. Your ideas are probably not mainstream, but I study hip hop constantly. I'm constantly listening at what's new, not just what the songs are, but what makes people move, right? You know, I'll give you an example. 1990s gangster rap. Gangster rap had this feel to it. Now everything is actually slower, but people double time move to it. So it's like boom, boom, boom. Right? But it's half time, but everybody dances in double speed. And so when I produce somebody that's kind of stuck in the gangster era, I'm always surprised, like, dude, you're 26. The fuck are you doing way back there? I should be the one, you know. But it's really hard. It's a lot of pressure. But at the same time, you know, Terry Date, who was not a rap artist at all, he was an engineer, taught me a lot about the business itself and about the feel of music and how to mix it and all that stuff. And I took all that with me, you know, and I try to pass some stuff on. And sometimes the expectations are a little unrealistic, though.
And also pretty close to a scratch golfer, for what it's worth.
Yeah. Is that right?
He's got some skills, yes.
Yeah. Same question for you. I know you've helped musicians, and I'm sure. Look, if you're a young musician, you're looking for some advice. And I know that you know the business particularly well because I've talked to you a lot about that.
Yeah.
What same thing with Mix? I mean, do people look at you and go, okay, show me how to become a big star? I mean, is it going to be frustrating from that way?
I believe it or not, people are not lined up in that way to ask me my opinion about most of this stuff, but it does happen here and there. And mostly, you know, it's very rarely about how do I become a better drummer or something, because maybe, I don't know, I got to where I was by putting in the reps, not by being some crazy, other, you know, just a special generational talent or, it was just doing it, doing the reps. And that's kind of the message that I like to bring is the, listen, those songs are good. Write 10 more and then trash 5 of them and then write 10 more, you know, like just get it going. And that's kind of the way we did it before. It looks now like you just put one song and you write one song and then put it on Spotify. And then you wait for that to blow up and then you write one more song, put that on Spotify. But that is not how it's going to work for you. Certainly didn't work for us that way. You got to just keep going. Take a gig, take another gig, take a crappy gig, take two crappy gigs. Be picky at some point and take medium gigs and then good gigs, whatever it is. But you just got to, the reps are more important than, you know, and obviously the Gladwell people got to this first.
To your point about people just doing one song at a time, yeah. I had a 19-year-old kid ask me yesterday on a Zoom call. We were all on a call talking about, you know, producing and how to release and publishing and all that. This I said, I used the word album. This kid had no idea. He said, what's an album? He said, my mom always uses that word. What is an album? I'm like, oh my God. Never mind.
Kids these days.
I know. I've only recently evolved to where my default used to be calling them records, which I realized was even more wildly outdated. So I have migrated to album, which is also crazy anachronistic, but at least a little bit more.
That's a cool track.
Yeah, tracks.
I thought disc would serve me for longer than it did, but nobody knows what a compact disc is. Anyways, he gets, hey, Mix, I like that new disc. What are you talking about? Yeah. Although that is the old vinyl thing. Old DJs called them discs.
Even if you just say owning music, people don't even know what that means. What do you mean owning music? I'm like, I have these things called records, and I own their mind. I'm not listening to them on a streaming service. I own them. How'd you do that? I'm like, never mind.
One of my favorite stories ever came from a guy both of us, all of us know. Duff McKagan told me one night that he, many years ago, his daughters are upstairs. He goes, what are you guys up to? And they go, we found this cool site and we're downloading music. And he goes, okay, we're going to have a family meeting. And he brought him downstairs and said, let's explain why you're not downloading any free music and why you're going to pay for any music you get. And it's funny how, you know, again, just the technology and how things evolve. You never would have thought when you're creating music, and it's so hard to create music, and it's so hard to make a buck in that industry, and it always has been. And now, oh, by the way, now you might create the greatest thing ever, and within a day, it's available to everybody for free. You know, the things you've had to adjust to in this business are crazy.
Yes, but there are upsides to that, too. It might be free for everybody, but somehow, whoever's got the most popular track on streamers is making plenty of money. You know, it's not like nobody, it's not like nobody's able to quit their job mowing lawns to do music full time.
Right.
The listeners come to you. You will do well. You keep creating. You keep connecting.
Keep plugging. Okay, so here's what we got to do. When the Sonics come back, I think, and I certainly can't pay for this. I'm coming up with
idea. They're coming back.
You guys are going to have to pay for it. We get a suite at the arena for opening night, and we just have a party so wild that we're asked to leave like halfway through the opening night game. That they basically, there's been a disturbance up on the suite level, and they're shutting down the suite because the music and the party was too raucous.
Yeah, that sounds like us for sure. Yeah,
look at us.
Hey, Gas, I toured the arena with Sean Kemp. It was me, Sean Kemp, and a few other people running around in there, man. And that place, I don't know if you've been inside of it, but
yeah,
my God, those suites are insane. Oh, I would love to tear one up with you, though.
Well, and I have not seen a music show there yet. Jason, I don't know if you've seen anybody there yet, but all the reviews I've heard so far is that the sound, and I know they put a ton of effort into making the sound better. I don't know how great you can make an arena sound, but I know every dollar they could spend on making, because they want to be able to do a ton of concerts, and they don't want anybody leaving saying, well, it was okay, but I couldn't hear anything. You know, you want to be able to hear, and the technology is available now to make it good, and that should really help as hopefully we get out of this pandemic and more and more people can gather and go to things and we start having shows again.
Yeah. That's super smart, because for a market this big, you know, we don't, after the WAMU, which is about, I think, 4,000 or something, you know, you got to go to Everett to get or to Tacoma. Crack 10,000 or Tacoma, and that's way more, you know. So I don't know why everybody hasn't been doing this for 20 years in every town. You take the basketball arena, that's the right amount of people, because that's the same amount of people as a shed, and the sheds are what make all the money during the summer. This might be too inside of baseball. But yes, you need a good 10,000-ish cap venue in your city. I don't care which city you are, you need that. So I hope we've done a nice job at Old Climate Pledge.
But Justin Bieber,
anybody who wants to take me to a hockey game, I know nothing about hockey, but if you've got sweet tickets, I'm available.
Mix just said he'd take you to see Justin Bieber, if I heard that right.
Sweet.
I don't
know. Thanks. Yeah, I'm kind of a Bieber head.
You'd go. You'd have a fun time.
Yeah.
I thought about Dave Chappelle, but the floor seats are like $4,500 for the floor seats.
Oh, you got to be kidding!
good to be Dave Chappelle.
Yeah,
and he's gonna get boycotted, which is gonna make more people want to go.
Guys, I could go all day. It's fun talking to you. I'm glad you're both doing so well. Mix, you look fantastic. So do you, Jason. But you know. It's been
Jason
a life.
Always good.
That's what I was gonna say. Mick, used to look like crap. Jason always is looking good.
Exactly. I was. You couldn't tell whether I was laying down or standing up. I was so fat, man. So.
Well, maybe this subset thing will take off, and maybe there'll be one more great subset song in you, and it'll be some song about the return of the Sonics, and we can kind of tie this whole thing together with a bow.
Look at you pitching us. I like that.
Yeah. I got an idea, guys. I want a percent. I want some skin in the game.
Okay. Sure, let me write this down. Gas wants percentage if revenue is generated. All right. Got it.
Guys, thanks. I appreciate it.
All right, you guys.
Thanks, Cass.
Jason Finn, the drummer for the Presidents of the United States of America, and Sir Mix-a-Lot from the World of Mix. Guys, I've appreciated knowing you over the years, and I can't thank you enough for being on Iconic Sonics. Great conversation, great talk, and good luck to both of you with all the future stuff. Iconic Sonics featuring Sir Mix-a-Lot and Jason Finn, thank you for participating. And remember, to get more exciting information and fun stuff and general mayhem, just go to iconicsonics.com. I'm Mike Gastineau. Thanks for listening.